Hello, I'm Ellen Stofan, the John and Adrian Mars Director of the Smithsonian's National Air and Space Museum. Joining me is Steve Monfort, the John and Adrian Mars Director of the Smithsonian's National Zoo and Conservation Biology Institute.
Thanks, Ellen. Understanding planet Earth is of critical importance to both of our organizations. And one of the most critical issues that we're dealing with is the threat of climate change. So in order to understand climate change and its impacts, we have scientists who study this phenomenon on land and in the air and under the sea. And in the second video of our series, we're hearing from NASA scientists and Smithsonian ecologists who track the changes seen on the Earth's surface.
Remote sensing satellites and space-based tracking technologies show the impacts of climate change on forests and savannas and the animals that rely on them. One of the most frequently cited data sets for this work comes from a series of satellites that began imaging the Earth almost 40 years ago. These satellites, part of NASA's Landsat program, provide the longest continuous space-based record of Earth's land in existence, and it's all made available to the public for free.
Hello, everyone. My name is Carlos Del Castillo, and I am a NASA scientist at NASA Goddard Space Flight Center. And today I am talking with my great colleague, Jeff Masek, also a scientist at NASA Goddard Space Flight Center. Jeff, very nice to talk to you today.
Nice to talk to you, Carlos.
Jeff, could you tell us what is it that you do at NASA?
Right. So I study global vegetation patterns using satellite imagery. And that's basically what remote sensing is using sensors that are airborne or in orbit to remotely sense what's going on the ground. And in my case, what I'm looking at are changes in ecosystems through time. They might be related to climate change. They might be related to human activities like land use. It might be related to natural disturbances like fires and insect outbreaks. But in each case, we can sense those changes using satellite imagery and make a record through time of what those changes are. And so that's really what I do in NASA, is study the dynamics and patterns of how ecosystems are changing using the satellite imagery.
Could you go a little bit further into why it's so special to use NASA assets for this type of work versus the typical way we have been doing science for some time, which is just going to the field and collecting samples?
Yeah, I mean, you really need to do both, right? I mean, you get that sort of local picture when you go to the field and you can actually identify individual species and the individual organisms, for example, when you're studying biodiversity. But what the satellite data gives you is that large scale picture, and also the continuity, right? So as I said, for Landsat, we've been launching satellites that are form of a continuity record since 1972, so almost 50 years now. It's very difficult to do that kind of field work over a global scale for that long a period of time. And so that continuity record is really essential for looking at long-term changes, changes that are slow, changes that may be driven by gradual processes like climate change or gradual encroachment of humans into the landscape, for example.
So from the perspective of that big picture, what do you see as the most interesting discoveries that you have seen using these fascinating data types?
So in my own research, I've been focusing on vegetation disturbance and climate change impacts in North America primarily. We did a study a few years ago looking at how vegetation greenness was being affected by climate change across the Circumarctic, for example. And we saw very pronounced, greening patterns, basically more vegetation in tundra and shrub environments in high latitudes. And that was really almost certainly a direct impact of climate warming, longer growing seasons, and so forth. And so it's fascinating to me when you can look at particular areas and see the impacts, for example, of climate change, not just in sort of a temperature record or an atmospheric record, but actually on the ground in terms of how vegetation is responding and probably how animals are responding as well.
So it is clear that we have a very strong scientific value that we can extract from this data. But could you go a little bit into what other societal benefits can we get from this data set? How is the non-scientist benefiting from this?
I think, you know, my background, I started out in college wanting to be an historian, actually an archaeologist, and I always loved the historical perspective of being able to understand change through time. And so for me, the satellite record is really that that key, where we have now 50 years where we can look at gradual changes as well as sudden disturbances and sort of put the pieces together and understand not only that change is occurring, but, you know, why it's occurring. You know, again, in the case of Landsat, which I deal with, it's heavily used by agribusiness, the agricultural ministries and agencies around the world. We're looking at crop growth patterns and where there's agriculture and where there's irrigated versus rain-fed agriculture. It's used for forest management. It's used to study encroachment of urbanization into natural areas and deforestation. It's a big, big application. So there are a lot of very practical benefits that come out of the satellite data records.
So Jeff, what is the next big question for you?
So I'm really interested in increasing the temporal density that we have of land observations. Landsat has been primarily either an 8 or a 16-day repeat cycle for many, many years. By combining those data with data from many other international systems, we can get to a daily repeat cycle. So we can actually look at how vegetation systems are changing day to day. And that ties into things like the physiology of vegetation. And also that seasonal cycle, as you look at it day to day, ties into the composition. We can actually tell you, again, sort of what species is growing where. And then what's interesting to me is taking that back and looking at compositional changes in forests, for example, and how composition of forests may have changed due to climate change.
Well, thanks a lot. This is a fascinating topic. This was Jeff Masek, NASA scientist from NASA Goddard Space Flight Center. I'm Carlos Del Castillo, also a NASA Goddard Space Flight Center. Thank you for your attention.
Thanks, Carlos.
To really understand the implications of our changing landscapes, we need to understand how quickly animals might adapt to new climatic conditions or to overcome new barriers to their movement. Here we take a look at how climate change and human activity are impacting one of the world's most iconic migratory species, the white-bearded wildebeest in East Africa.
Hi, I'm Francesca Cagnacci. I'm a movement ecologist studying terrestrial mammals at Fondazione Mumach. And today I have the pleasure of speaking to Jared Stabach, who is an ecologist at the Smithsonian Conservation Biology Institute and a program coordinator for the Smithsonian's Movement of Life Initiative. Jared, I would love to learn more about your work today. I know that you actually study some among the most iconic species on Earth, African ungulates, right? And that you track their movements in fascinating environments. But how does this dream job exactly happen? What is your annual and daily routine, and what tools do you use to accomplish these objectives?
Yeah, well, first, Francesca, I'd just like to say it's a real pleasure to speak with you about things that we're really passionate about. And for sure, this really is the dream job. This is something I always have wanted to do. And I think part of that mix of getting where I am today is, I think, starting off with understanding the biology or ecology of the animals I study. And then there's a part of me that's just really interested in the tech side of things. So, you know, fitting animals with tracking devices and also merging where the animals are going with some kind of remotely sensed imagery. So satellite data to really get a better image on how the landscape is changing. In many ways, I think, you know, my job is kind of a merge of the best of both worlds. So I do spend quite a bit of time with local partners in African systems, while at the same time, I might be receiving data on the animals that we're actually tracking, and I can receive those data back here in my office.
Wow, this is amazing, because it's like you would daily take a journey alongside these fascinating animals. But what are you learning when you study their movements? What, you know, do you, can you share some special story about what they do or about important discoveries that you're doing?
Yeah, I think the important thing is that these tracking devices really are revolutionary, and they really open up a brand new world about how these animals that we're tracking are responding to environmental change. For me, I think it's really interesting because even though we do know quite a bit about these animals, from a scientific perspective, we're only starting to learn. There's so many questions for us to still answer. And the populations that I study are the more quote unquote resident populations in Kenya. So these are the populations that most people don't really know that much about. And just to give you an idea, we studied 15 animals in the greater Mara ecosystem in Kenya. And these were all thought to be animals that only spent their time in Kenya. And from our small sample of 15, about 5 of those animals crossed the boundary into Tanzania. They moved through Serengeti National Park. They moved past the Loliondo Game Reserve. And in one case, we had an animal that moved very south of the system towards the Ngorongoro Conservation Area. Round trip, it was like a 200-kilometer migration. So really interesting movements of these animals.
Yeah, so it's like amazing stories have been under our eyes for millennia and we wouldn't realize, right? But you were saying that you track these animals and get to know about their lives through GPS devices. However, it looks like this incredible extent they travel through cannot be potentially known, if not by satellite tracking and, satellites. And you were mentioning that. Can you tell us more about this? How does it work? How do you match the information?
Yeah, I think the important thing is that the Earth observation satellites have a record that go back to the early 1970s. So we almost have a 50-year record of how the landscape is changing, and we can really understand the anthropogenic change, but we also can understand just the phenology change, so how vegetation is changing over time. So because each of those items have a timestamp, we can merge the track data actually with the satellite. And so we start to be able to evaluate not just how the animals are moving, but why they're moving in that way. So how far are they from roads, from fences? How are they able to track that vegetation as it changes? And you know, how far do they have to move to basically optimize their forage?
And how is the outlook? Are they exposed to threats? Do we have only worrisome news, or is there actually a way to make a difference by these studies?
Yeah, so the impacts of these species, especially wildebeest, for instance, are immense. And from the satellites, we're able to track how rapidly that landscape is changing. And over the last 5 years, there's been a almost exponential increase in the amount of fencing. And for wildebeest, that is a really difficult boundary for the animals to cross, especially if they're trying to get from their dry season range to their wet season range. And so what we're observing, unfortunately, is a widespread decline in many of these populations. I think that the good news is that the data provides us information on how they're responding to those changes so that we can provide it to policymakers. It also means that, you know, something like a fence is something that we actually can remove. So by providing that information to local people and local policymakers, we can say that the most important route that these animals take is through this particular area. So we're best off taking down those fences so that we allow the behaviors of these animals to continue, so that we both have a balance between improving human livelihoods while at the same time we maintain the important biodiversity that exists across the landscape.
Yeah, and I'm really glad to hear that there is a positive possibility in terms of mitigating. Thank you very much, Jared, for your conversation.
You're welcome. Thank you.